If you thought I said some weird stuff before, brace yourself. I'm from another world, one that's far, far away in the sky.
Another world, you say?
Far away in the sky?
Stoush and the Divine Force is available since August 27th and the new installment of the franchise. I am a big fan of the PS1 and PS2 games A Second Story and Till the End of Time, so that's why I picked it up. In my review, I'm going to mention everything you need to know about the game and if Stoush and the Divine Force is something that JRPG fans might want to check out. You can choose at the beginning of the game between two characters. Depending on who you decide to play, the game will focus more on the perspective of the chosen character and the backstory. You can choose between Raymond Lawrence, who is the captain of the space merchant ship Eidas. Ray is on a delivery mission, and his ship surprisingly gets attacked by a Galactic Federation battleship. Luckily, Ray and his crew manage to evacuate in escape pods, but landed on an underdeveloped planet. His goals are to regroup with his crew and finding out what's going on up in the sky. On the other side, you have Leticia Osirius. She is the crown princess of the Kingdom of Osirius, which is located just on that underdeveloped planet Ray landed. Leticia is on her own personal mission to save her kingdom from the threat of the neighboring Vaerl Empire. No matter who you decide to pick, both will meet early in the game and agree to help each other. So both characters are going to be most of the game in your party, and you're going to be able to switch between them in combat. Only difference is that on various occasions both characters will get separated for a certain amount of time, which gives you their perspective in certain events.
You should go, Leticia.
Now?
You can assign various attacks, magic spells, or even item usage to three buttons and three more by holding each button. It's really up to personal preference how you change your combos. You can set three standard combos and ends with a stronger attack. I created three combinations of light, strong attacks and magic spells and mix those into combos depending on the situation. This chain combo system will not only give you a huge amount of combinations, but also various options in your game plan. You can rush with your support characters straight into battle, fight from the distance with magic spells, or set a combination of both. Progressing in the game will add more characters into your party, which can be managed with their own individual attacks. Ray may look like more of a character from the New Kids Turbo movie, but don't let his appear fool you, since he has the strongest physical attacks in the game. The Boulder Crush is probably the strongest attack and will finish standard enemies with ease. Downside, however, is that most of the attacks are slow and combining them together requires timing and sacrificing a good chunk of your action points. Next we have Leticia. She can charge her dual swords with elementary boost and put enemies with combos constantly into pressure. Albert has some strong attacks from the distance. With his chakras you can attack multiple enemies at once or perform magic spells. A character that I prefer always to have in my team was Nina. She is a support character and will buff stats and heal teammates during battles. Those were only 4, and the game lets you unlock up to 10 characters in total with their own unique moves. While in control of one character, there is the possibility to give the rest commands in the pause menu while time stands still, for example to fight only opponents you are not focusing on, which is definitely recommended when fighting multiple enemies at once. While fighting bosses, you can focus the entire party to attack altogether. If you get overwhelmed by enemies, then it be because of two things. First, you have not optimal set each attacks from your party, or second,
it's because you got no guns.
Luckily, lastly can be upgraded in the character's skill tree. Same goes for the attack power, intelligence, defense and health stat. There is also a good amount of new attacks that can be unlocked. You have to spend SP points you gain after battles. Unlocking attacks will give you more possibilities for combos. You can enhance and strengthen skills. Setting different attacks not only for your main but also for your support characters was surprisingly more fun than I expected. I spent hours in that menu without even knowing.
Almost half an hour in the menu. Damn.
Almost at the start of the game, you'll gain Duma. The best way to describe Duma is
a most useful orb, if not somewhat annoying.
Duma lets you rush into each enemy, which does, depending on the VA gauge, more or less additional damage. This is especially useful when fighting enemies in air or to reach weak points of the bigger guys. If you rush into one enemy's blindside, you can stun them for a certain amount of time. This will add more AP points, which lets you create bigger combos. The AP boost can be carrying over into the next battle. Rushing from one enemy to another is really fun. To reach the blindside from your enemies, you can surprise attack before the battle or maneuver out of his field of vision. This will require some good timing and some IP points, but in the end, it can make the difference how the fight ends. If you fill your waiting gauge, you'll be able to perform a special move. Each character has its own. While Rey's Extreme Daredevil deals damage, others like Leticia's Ultimate Kamui creates buffs. My favorite is Marielle Exceed Burst, that looks like a Marvel vs. Capcom special move.
Try not to feel like you need to pull any more than that though. Right. I know. Bringing out the big guns!
Duma can be used also in a more passive way. With the so-called S3 cage, Duma will enhance defense from the entire party with a barrier. However, you'll not be able to rush or perform special moves in this mode. Duma can be used also as a jetpack to reach higher platforms where you can find hidden chests or the so-called Tuma points while you explore world map regions. With those Tuma points, you can upgrade Duma's active and passive abilities. In villages or towns, you'll find NPCs that gives you side quests. It's basically go there, kill a bunch of enemies and or gain certain items. You can find some NPCs you can challenge through a Esowa match. Esowa is a miniature game. Depending on how strong your miniatures are, you do more damage. Throughout the game, you will find more and stronger miniatures. Some represents characters from previous Star Ocean games, which is a nice touch. In villages, you not only find inns with a diner that gives you a specific boost for a certain amount of time, but also shops. In those, you can buy weapons, armor, and or all kinds of potions. You can do that also in the create menu, which you unlock if you do certain side activities for Welsh. The more you complete, the more options you have in the craft menu. If you want to find out more about your companions, you do that by having conversations in the cities. Sometimes that will lead to the so-called side stories cutscenes.
Have you ever wished you could reach maturity in a quicker manner?
What do I have to do to get an older man to like me? I need to know!
What's this?
From everything I mentioned, the game looks like a nice adventure you can't pass, but unfortunately the game has some small and bigger issues. Let me start with the combat system. The combat system that sounds great is overshadowed by small but crucial flaws. First, the lock system. Like in any game, you can lock and focus on one specific enemy by pressing the right analog stick. While focused on your enemy, you can set the cursor to another one with the mini stick buttons. The problem is here that you can't change that in the control menu, which will make you constantly lose your rhythm during combat since you have to sacrifice movement or your sight to change to your next opponent. If you fight one enemy further away from the rest, you'll have to reset the lock, which will leave you without orientation. This is clearly noticeable in air. While trying to rush to the next enemy and floating in the air, you have to readjust the camera to the opponent flying exactly next to you. It is on one hand semi-automatic, but trusting into that will leave you in constantly swinging and missing attacks or just rush into nothing. Another point is here that pressing the right analog stick is also resetting the camera at the same time. Your enemy must be centered, otherwise you will reset the camera during battle. You can set the camera movement faster and adapt to that problem, but I really felt that somewhat restricted my playstyle. Second, the AP system. The idea of the AP system is to bring balance into combat. Having the endless amount of attacks will no doubt make the fighting easier than it is. But there were simply too many situations where I really felt that the AP system is holding back unleashing more fun in battles. It really feels good when you manage to rush to each enemy and finish them one by one with combos you said previously in the menu, especially when you do that in air. But the excitement ended many times abruptly because I was out of points. When fighting against tougher enemies, you'll lose AP points in no time, which will slow down the battle. You'll have to strike one or two times, retreat, and repeat. I feel here that Triads could have added the possibility to overdrive Duma to extend AP points unlimited for a period amount of time, but unfortunately you can't. The combat is fast-paced, action-oriented, but on a turn-by-turn formula and feels in this game that one side is holding back the other. Sometimes your enemies will disappear and the combat will end with the hint you escaped successfully. You have to attack again to initialize battle. There were also situations where your support characters were stuck in combat and not moving, or throwing attacks and not hitting enemies. If you assign your teammates with magic attacks or attacks that suits more to fight from the distance, your teammates will stand in front of your enemies no matter what. Strong magic attacks that requires almost 10 seconds to charge are useless most of the times used by your companions, since they will get interrupted many times. Against certain boss fights, that is an instant death. Also, for whatever reason, accessories of my companions will come off, which will make you re-sign them every now and then. At the end, I was so annoyed that I just put figurines, since they won't come off. Marielle and JJ are probably the coolest characters in the game, but it will take 20 hours to unlock Marielle and 28 or more for JJ. After unlocking them, the game is ridiculously easy. If you do here and there some side objectives, you will be overleveled in no time. The last phase of the game will become, because of that, incredible dull and boring, since all the combos and moves will not matter anymore. The sandbox map sections of the game are huge but completely empty. If you follow the path that brings you to the next village, you'll encounter two or three small groups of enemies. Some of the maps you literally have to search for enemies. I was running zigzagging in the map just to find more fights. When you manage to reach the 10 hour mark, the story will finally be somewhat serious, which brings me to my next point. The presentation of this game is simply ugly. I am used JRPG games not being able to deliver blockbuster graphics, and that's totally fine with me, but I have the feeling that this installment of the franchise looks even worse than previous games, and they were already ugly. It seems that Square Enix is just putting enough effort into the Final Fantasy franchise and done here the bare minimum, with the rest by giving them to developers with small budgets. The character design of the main characters are just so bad. Even random NPCs and villages are looking better. You can't really tell if the person who talks is an elder or a kid.
Ah, Nina! Fiends have appeared from the mines to the east. There are many wounded. We need you.
Why is this guy having a voice of a grandpa? It looks like 15 years old.
If our knights are to face the Imperials, we will have need of them.
Do not suffer children their foolish dreams. You are what.
This is a kid?
The problem is here that Tri-Ace has copy-pasted most faces and just changed hairstyle and eye color. Also, for whatever reason, the animation of clothes and hair is weird. Ida's hat, for whatever reason, looks like about to fly off and reminds me of Super Mario Odyssey.
Oh, my goodness. I'm almost falling asleep right now.
The combat system has its flaws, but overall you will find enjoyment. I will explain, however, why this game is a mediocre experience. Star Ocean: The Divine Force tries too hard to deliver that intergalactic epic story experience and fails with a blunt attempt to recapture what made Star Ocean so special. The game stretches itself with non-relevant conversations, horrible and cringe cutscenes, or segments that doesn't really add anything. Let me give you a perfect example for that. There is this preparation phase where you are about to attack the Empire, but have to wait 7 days. Instead of just jumping 7 days later, you're going to have each day 10 minutes of BS conversation with characters that doesn't give you any new information about the planet or characters. There are tons of those time-wasting scenarios in the game. You have a conversation, main character needs to rest. The next day, another conversation, main character needs to rest. You do this 3 to 4 times before that gets to anywhere.
Oh, for the fifth time, how many times do you need to rest?
The endgame feels like a Mass Effect trilogy squeezed into 10 hours with barely any budget. Seriously, even the end boss calls himself Sovereign. And let's not talk about the boss fight encounters. You fight throughout the game the same handlangers over and over again. I wouldn't mind if they would be somehow stronger, but they are ridiculously easy since first encounter. Which brings me to the next problem. I play the entire game in universe, and while it's challenging at the beginning, it will become a joke after 12 hours or so. After spending so much time in the menu to set the perfect combos for each character, unlocking so many new skills, and experimenting with characters, adding new accessories just to end up every fight with one or two light attacks. I really didn't even care much and had to almost 2000 SP points to spend, and that only in half of the game. I needed 35 hours and I play the entire game in universe. If you do all the side missions, you'll have 40 hours minimum. You can also replay the game to get the other character's perspective. The combat system is fun if you find your ways to manage the unblock system at the beginning. Unfortunately, just when it gets to be fun, it automatically becomes extremely easy. The character animation's overall presentation is so bad that I personally think Tri-S has done that on purpose to deliver the most funny satire story experience on the PS5.
I nearly forgot. Here, it is news from the capital. A woman by the name of Chloe Canaris, was it? Has been found. Miss Kern.
That little poster over there.
Chancellor Neon himself.
Make it smaller so nobody can see it.
Wait, what? My final rating for Star Ocean: The Divine Force is a 6 out of 10.
Which I thank you for watching, and see you.